through Ishray.
Welcome to all panelists, all dignitaries and speakers. Soini Ben, please start your end.
Hello everyone, very good evening. My name is Sohini and I am very happy to have all of you here with us today. Ishray Ahmedabad chapter and women in Ishray welcomes you to today's webinar on building insulation. Talking a little bit about our topic for today, with the rising temperatures all around the world, keeping our buildings cooler has become a challenge. Hence, along with air conditioners, thermal insulation has become a necessity in our buildings, and in order to obtain thermal comfort and energy efficiency, we need to thermally insulate our buildings. So we are going to begin with our today's webinar with the first session, which is on latest trends of thermal insulation. The speaker is Mr. Amit Patil. He is a regional technical sales manager of Hira Group. He's a mechanical engineer with more than 15 years of experience in sales and marketing, material handling, inventory and planning. He has spent 6 years in HVAC, plumbing and firefighting industry. He has been associated with companies like Kirloskar, Caterpillar, Hilti, Fisher, and has been dealing with products such as thermal and acoustic insulation, passive fire stop products, MEP installation systems, and capital equipment. So I will hand over the mic to Mr. Amit Patil, who will be continuing with this session on latest trends of thermal insulation.
Good evening, everyone. I'll be sharing my screen. Is the screen visible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
All right. So a very good evening to everybody over here. Thank you, Ishray, for giving us an opportunity to present on this very hot topic nowadays, which is the thermal insulation and the significance it has in the HVAC industry altogether. So this is the agenda for the presentation. What we'll be covering up, we'll be covering the basics of HVAC. Concentrating more on the thermal insulation part of it, and basic types of insulation, then the important aspects regarding insulation, fire and smoke standards, which play a very critical role nowadays of so many incidents happening in and around us, and a few of the application photos just to have an overview of how the installation looks like and so on. So when we talk about thermal insulation, so when there is a temperature difference between two objects, the heat flow is inevitable. We cannot avoid the heat flow. So the heat will always flow from higher temperature to the lower temperature, irrespective of the size, mass, or position of the objects. So the air conditioned or the refrigerated space is normally at a lower temperature because we need to achieve that temperature. Then the surroundings, and the heat would therefore try to penetrate from outside to the inside colder areas. So the cold insulation should therefore be considered where operating temperatures are below ambient temperature, where protection is required against heat gain, condensation or freezing. Refrigeration and air conditioning is a process where the temperature is lowered by pumping out heat from the colder place, where heat is not actually required to a place, and it is extracted to the area where it is not objectionable. So the area which we want to cool down, it is cooled in that manner. Thermal insulation therefore provides a layer of material in which thermal conduction or heat ingress is reduced and thermal radiation is reflected there, rather than absorbed by the lower temperature body. So everybody is aware of this three phenomenons of the heat transfers, namely conduction, convection, and radiation. So conduction is a movement of heat from one object to another, one that has different temperatures when they are actually physically in contact with each other. Second is the convection mechanism of heat, occurs in liquids and gases, wherein flow processes transfer the heat. In convection, if we consider, there are two types. One is the free convection, wherein the flow is caused due to the difference in the density as a result of temperature differences. Second is the forced convention, wherein we have got areas in our pharmaceutical and companies wherein we need to keep them, you know, cool, and also we have to provide some external influences like the ventilators, the fans, to give, you know, forced convections. Third is the radiation mechanism, which occurs due to, you know, the source to something else. All hot things radiate heat to cooler things. Just the example for that is how the earth gets, you know, warmer due to the heat from the sun. Now, how this is, you know, related to the insulation. Now, heat transfer through insulation material occurs by the means of conduction. That means the temperature, the medium through which the fluid or whatever is passing through, and the insulation material, the heat transfer is, which occurs is due to the conduction. And while heat loss or the heat gain from atmosphere occurs by the means of convection or radiation. In general, the greater the density of the material, the greater is the thermal conductivity. Just for example, metals, say any metals you take, have a high density and a high thermal conductivity. That is the reason when they come in contact with heat, they get heated very soon because they have a good thermal conductivity. Materials which have a low thermal conductivity are those which have a high proportion of small voids of air and gases inside it. They contain voids of gas and air. These voids are not big enough to transmit heat by convection or radiation, and therefore reduce the flow of heat. If the density of insulation is low, the air or gas voids are comparatively larger, and this makes for the best insulation for low to medium temperatures. So thermal insulation materials falls into the later category, that is, they have a bigger voids with gas into them, so that, you know, they contain, they have a low thermal conductivity as compared to the other metals and all. Now, what is insulation basically? You know, so thermal insulation is a material used in air conditioning and a refrigeration industry to act as a resistance or a barrier for transfer of heat from higher temperature to lower temperature. Or what we consider as thermal insulation is the temperature range from minus 75 degrees to plus 8.5 degrees centigrade. So whatever insulation is done for that, that is considered to be as a thermal insulation. Anything beyond or ahead of that is considered, you know, below 75, minus 75 degrees, it is considered to be as cryogenic, and above 8.5 degrees, it is considered to be as a refractory. Why insulation is necessary? Thermal insulation system is a combination of materials, ancillaries for applications, methodology which resists the flow of environment heat to inside of a building or enclosure, which is supposed to be maintained at much lower temperature than outside. In India, this is the case basically. The ambient temperatures are always, you know, on the higher side most of the time of the season. Wherein, if you go to the other countries and all, the room temperature basically is much higher than the ambient temperatures. Thermal insulation will resist the flow of heat by acting as a barrier to stop the heat transfer. The most effective insulation material will provide maximum resistance and will be defined by a particular R value, which is very much important to define the thermal conductivity of any insulation material, which will depend upon its thermal conductivity value and thickness. Lower the thermal conductivity of the insulation material, the more effective it will be. Now, thermal insulation application types basically. The major applications wherein thermal insulation is I would say bifurcated is ventilation, air conditioning, cooling, and heating. So there are major two reasons why thermal insulation is very much important. As one is the very first and foremost important is the condensation control. So that is to prevent water ripping or ice buildup or even corrosion for that matter. And second is minimizing the thermal loss. It is very much important to understand that the cost of energy for cooling is much more higher than it is required for the heating process basically. So that makes insulation a very critical point of, you know, application when in any projects or any job sites as such. Benefits of insulation material is a few, we'll just go through it. It reduces heat gain or heat loss, prevents moisture penetration and acts as a vapor barrier, which is very much important to maintain the line temperature. Acoustical performance of insulating material, it helps reducing the noise because there are a lot of equipments which create the vibrations and the noise due to that. So this insulation also acts as an acoustic barrier in avoiding the the sound which is produced by that vibrations and all. Prevents condensation, water dripping from ducting, piping, drain pans and ceiling, etc. It prevents ice accumulation and freeze protection. Enhances process performance because the line temperature is maintained and reduces energy consumption. Controls surface temperatures to avoid contact burns. Basically, in person, if you get to touch because of the insulation, we can avoid that burns. Fire safety, it helps in slowing spread of fire in a building in case of a fire incident. Basically, majorly we bifurcate the insulation materials in class O, class 1 and class 2 and so on. So provides more accurate control of process temperatures by minimizing fluctuations and protection of the product. Improves the appearance of the equipment, piping, AHUs, because aesthetically it makes the project, the job site looks very aesthetic. So when you add a very good kind of insulation with laminations, there are so many types of laminations which are available in the market looking at the aesthetics. It helps in reducing carbon emission. So majorly, we would talk that insulation material structures, we are bifurcated in between three major parts, I would say. One is the fiber structures, which are the open fiber structures. Second is the open cell insulation, what we talk about. And third is the closed cell insulation. Majorly, what we will be discussing about in today's webinar will be about the closed cell insulations. So this is the bifurcation, what we do normally. Fibrous insulation is composed of small diameter fibers, which finely divide the air space. Just for the example, it would be the rock wool, mineral wool, where you see the fibers, thin fibers. Second is the cellular insulation, wherein we talk about the closed cell insulation. For that matter, you can take nitrile rubber or XLP and so on, EPDM for that matter. Third is the granular insulation, which composed of small nodules which may contain voids or hollow spaces. It is not considered a true cellular material since gas can be transferred between the individual spaces. So the examples of that can be calcium silicate, the expanded vermiculite or perlite, cellulose and so on. Fourth is the vacuum insulation, which is which actually the application is for the very higher temperature. So these layers are normally of aluminium, copper, gold layers or so on. So to get a better idea about the materials, when we talk about open cell, the examples would be stone wool, glass wool, or cork, melamine foam, polystyrene can be XPS and EPS both, then aerogel. Then a semi-open cell, when we talk about it, is polyurethane, polystyrene, polyethylene. And again, then when we talk about the closed cell, it is the glass foam, which is XLP and any nitrile rubber. So when we talk about the closed cell insulation, we have got the thermal insulation, which is nitrile rubber as well. Then thermal insulation, which is XLP. This is cross-linked closed cell polyethylene. And the acoustic products, which is the semi-open and the open cell. Oh, when we talk about XLP, a lot of people, a few of them, they consider it to be the closed cell, a cross-linked closed cell polyethylene, and few of them consider it to be closed cell polyolefin. So why is polyolefin basic? Because actually polyolefin is a group of plastics, wherein polyethylene is one of the product of it. The rest of them all, it can be either polypropylene or polymethyl pentene and so on. When we talk about the nitrile rubber, which is the elastomer group, basically, we have got the nitrile rubber, which is nitrile butadiene rubber. Then we have got EPDM, which is ethylene propylene diene rubber, and SBR and neoprene. So this is the nitrile rubber. It's just a pictorial view of how it looks like, the nitrile rubber. And this is what XLP looks like, basically. So the major the concern wherein the thermal insulation has to be taken very seriously while designing and while specifying as well when the designers work on a project or while at the initial stage of the designing. The condensation buildup, which is very much important. So what is condensation buildup? Basically, water vapor that turns into liquid form when warm and humid air comes into contact with cold surface. The best example can be when we remove a bottle of cold water from the fridge and when we keep it outside in the ambient room temperature basically. You see that water vapor which forms over the bottle. So that is nothing but the condensation which happens. So here you see a pipe and the insulation which is covering the pipe. Considering T2 be the ambient temperature basically, which is the temperature of the medium which is lower, and the ambient temperature which is considerably higher than the medium. So we have to see that the dew point doesn't, the surface temperature of the insulation should always be greater than the dew point temperature to avoid the condensation. So that is the reason it is very important to design the insulation as such that the surface temperature of the insulation is always higher than the dew point temperature. So this is how it is. Condensation safety factor and heat loss. So important key factors for thermal insulation to keep in mind is any thermal insulation what we consider for a project should always have a strong water vapor barrier, which is the mu factor. I'll be briefing it about the mu factor in the coming slides. And it should always have the lowest of the thermal conductivities. Use of the right insulation thickness, which is very much important. Then the correct insulation, however good the insulation is, if the installation is not done in a proper manner, if the joints are not properly glued, then there will always be a leakage and it will not perform at the fullest. And keeping the minimum distance among the insulated objects. They talk about the mu value. The mu value of a material is always known as its water vapor resistance factor. So it is a measure of material's relative reluctance to let water vapor pass through and is measured in comparison to the properties of the air. So this is one of the major factors which are considered in any of the insulation materials. So there are plenty of lower cost and common insulation materials available on the market today. Many of these have been around for quite some time. Now, each of these insulation materials have their own ups and downs. As a result, when deciding which insulation material, one should be sure that the selected material would work the best in your situation. So while different applications, different locations, the material, the insulation material will vary, the thickness will vary, the vapor barrier will vary accordingly. The closed cell insulation is the most commonly specified material used for cold work, which is the nitrile rubber, the XLP, the EPDM. Because it possesses a degree of resistance to water vapor, and because the thermal conductivity, which is the K factor of some of these materials, is better than the fibrous alternative products available in the market, which are the menwool and glass wool and so on. So low thermal conductivity is linked with water vapor resistance. So if you see, this is a pipe which has been insulated. So what it does is actually, the heat flow lambda, it will always try to, the water diffusion will always try to get into the insulation. To avoid that, the insulation should always have the higher, the lambda value, the lowest lambda value and the highest mu value for that matter. So this is the sectional view which has been given. So considering 22 degrees, that is the ambient temperature, and the RH, which is 70, if you consider the same on the line, the temperature should be approximately 6 degrees and the RH is 0. So there's a pressure difference of water vapor between ambient air and closed cell structure of insulation. So due to the temperature difference between the line and the ambient, the pressure difference is creating a diffusion flow, which is forcing the ambient water vapors into the insulation, that is towards the lower temperature. So for poor quality materials with low mu value, which is the water diffusion factor, insulation will get wet, as you can see, which is demonstrated over here. The vapors will try to penetrate the insulation and wet the insulation. Therefore, one should apply high quality insulation material, that is with high value of water vapor diffusion resistance factor. Second is the thermal conductivity. Thermal conductivity is a specific material property. It represents the heat flow in watts. It's the basic unit for it is watts per meter Kelvin and so on. The thermal conductivity depends on material, and for fluids, its temperature and pressure. For some materials, thermal conductivity may also depend upon the direction of heat transfer. Overall, if you see for comparison purposes, conductivity under standard conditions is always considered at a 20 degrees centigrade it's commonly used to have an apple to apple comparison. So here you can see the low mu value. What will happen is the water vapor will actually try to penetrate the insulation, and with high mu value you see it is content, it is not wetting the insulation material. Same as in the case of the lambda, which is the if the thermal conductivity of a material is low, you will get a constant thermal performance over the years. And with both of these not up to the mark, the you will get an unstable thermal performance over the area. So the performance of the complete system will try to deteriorate after several years of time. Optimum insulation thickness, it's a very important point, that how thick should be the insulation over any or the ducting or the chilled water pipeline. So the insulation thickness which has the total cost minimum is taken as the optimum insulation thickness. So when heat transfer into or out of a controlled temperature space results in cooling, application of insulation will reduce this cost. Each additional unit of thickness of insulation, however, is not progressively less effective. And the point is reached where additional thickness of insulation is not compensated for by the reduction in any operating cost. That means over and above, if you go for a thickness, we have a tendency that more the thickness, more the performance will get. But after the optimum insulation thickness, over and above whatever is applied over a ducting, or it is not going to give any benefit. It is not going to add to any advantage of the system. So this is the cost which is shown. A is the insulation cost, and second is the energy cost. We have to find the optimum point wherein the cost is saved. So this is the minimum required thickness what we have given for the, suppose say the diameter, pipe diameter of 15 mm, probably the thickness which will be required is 19 mm. But the same in case of 114 diameter of pipe, the thickness required would be around 24.5 or even higher than that. So a bigger insulation thickness is required for pipes with a bigger diameters, because the area of I would say the contact is higher. The more the diameter of the pipe, the area of contact is higher. That is the reason higher thickness of insulation is required for larger diameter of pipes. This is the pictorial view. You can see the pipe which is shown, a copper pipe, wherein it doesn't have any insulation, there is a freezing which is happening, a minimal thickness over it, and so on. Once you get a proper thickness over it, there is no condensation which is happening over the pipe. Depending on the pipe diameter, the minimum insulation thickness should be calculated. Obviously, there are other influencing parameters wherein the ambient temperature plays a major role, the line temperature, humidity plays a very important role while sizing of the thickness, insulation thickness, then the surface coefficient and the thermal conductivity of the insulation. Fourth is the installation joints. As I said, however expensive insulation you require, you install, or whatever thickness you require, if it is not installed properly, the system won't run at the 100% efficiency. So the system integrity is assured by following a right installation procedure and by using the right adhesive as well. So the adhesive glues the insulation surfaces through a chemical reaction, which has as result the cold vulcanization. This is the process by which actually the insulation is glued. Installation must be done with products which assure a good gluing at the joints and on the entire length of the pipe or duct or any material wherein the insulation is actually installed. Rigid insulation for that matter may often contain spaces. It's the limitations what the rigid insulation materials have due to wrong cutting, where condensation can appear. Fifth is the minimum distance among the insulation objects. Again, it's a very important factor to consider. You can see a pipe with the insulation. So there are so many, convective contribution of surface coefficient and the radiative contribution of surface coefficient, which is happening over and above the pipe. So higher probability of forming condensation is in the static areas. If you can see this picture, basically the duct which has been very closed to the ceiling and the wall, there is no airflow which is happening in that static area. Even in the case of these pipes, there is a static area in between the pipes, two pipes as well, and in between the pipe ceilings and the wall as well. So due to the static areas condensation, there are higher chances of condensation to happen over the insulation material. So to avoid it, there is always important to keep a specific gap in between the insulated bodies. So we have it somewhere like, for the equipments, you should always have a minimum gap, or I would say the distance of 1 meter. And in case of pipes or the ducts, you should always have a distance of approximately around 100 mm. It's practically, it is not always possible on the job sites, while even while designing, if the designer specifies the proper distance. While installation, it is always not, but the highest precautions should be taken that at least this much of distance should be considered to avoid condensation. So insulation does not initiate corrosion. This is again a very important point. Whenever you apply insulation over this, it does not allow any corrosion to happen over the pipe. These are some pictures of it. So I will be quickly going through some of the installation photographs, showing the application photographs. I will just run through it very fast, quickly. This is a nitrile rubber, which is the indoor applications. And you see, this is nitrile rubber. Alu glass is one of the actually laminations which you see over here, which is silver. This acts as an additional water vapor barrier to the insulation, and also adds to the mechanical strength, because you see this area, actually it is very much accessible to the people. So it is very much important to give it's at a mechanical strength as well. So to add we add the glass wool, the alu glass indoor, this thing. These are a few of the photographs of it. So this is the completely outdoor applications, wherein we need to take extra care because it is completely exposed to the UV rays, the climatical change, the rainy seasons and everything. So this is the clad which is over the nitrile rubber stone. Same as with the XLP, there's a few photographs of XLP. I'll just quickly go through it. So this is again XLP with enclad, which is a lot of laminations available in the market nowadays. The laminations, there is aluminium foil, then there is a glass cloth, there is a PVC clad which is available, there is an enclad. It comes in various thicknesses, right, ranging from 40 microns, and it goes up to 250 to 300 microns as well. These are photos of the condensation happening, not the proper insulation given to the chilled water pipelines. You see the duct wherein internally it has got completely rusted due to not applying the insulation, the duct liners. So main applications for XLP products, I would say, is it's ventilation, air conditioning, chilled water, hot water. The advantages of XLP, I would say it has got every insulation material has got some advantages, some limitations to it. So XLP being the plastic, it's a byproduct of plastic basically. So it is fast and reliable installation, long lasting thermal properties, extremely hygienic material is. It has got better chemical and mechanical resistance as compared to the other insulation materials. Same with nitrile rubber, cooling and refrigeration, liquid gases, heating and plumbing and air conditioning are few of the applications which are done with nitrile rubber. When we discuss about the insulation material, its properties, it is very much important to even see what are the standards the insulation material complies to, which are the bodies, the international bodies, the Indian bodies, which are actually approving the products for that matter. So whenever we discuss about any insulation material, these are the standards which are very much important to evaluate the performance of any insulation material. So first is considering the condensation control. Water vapor permeability is as per the ASTM E96. Water absorption should be as per the British standards, 12087 and ASTM C209. Same is with the water vapor diffusion resistance, which is BSEN 12086. Second, very much important again, is the thermal performance, which is which should be as per the American standard C518. Then the fire and smoke properties, the material should be class O, class 1 as per the BS 476 part 6 and 7. The smoke emission, which as per IMO MSC, the surface burning test ASTM E84. then it should always again have the health related concerns like the antimicrobial properties, the antifungal properties of the insulation. Then the environmental concerns are there nowadays when we are discussing more about the green buildings. And so this again makes it a very important that the VOC level, the ASTM D5116, these are a few of the standards which I have stated just to understand that this should be the, you know, standards whenever we are evaluating any of the insulation materials, because the manufacturers are spending a lot of money on this approvals, the testings and all, and then they come up to that technical specifications, something like that. This slide I have kept just to understand because nowadays so many fire incidents are happening. So people are trying to burn insulation at whatever place, and they are coming to a conclusion that this material is not class O because it is burning. So for that matter, every material I would say is combustible. Every material burns when it comes in contact with fire, because every material has got its own burning point. So at certain temperature, every material will burn. But at what extent and at what level it burns, actually that specifies the material to be class O or class 1. So this is the BS-476 material testing, which is the procedure is given. You see an oven. I will be going through a small video after this. The pilot flame is ignited. I would just go through the video. You'll get a better idea about it. So you see a pilot flame which is burning just outside the burner, and the specimen of the insulation is been taken into contact with the pilot flame. Sorry, I just... So at the end of this video, you will see that the pilot flame is taken off and the material is actually trying to self-extinguish itself. So this is how the classifications of any insulation material is done. So you must have seen the specimen, there's some specific length over it. So the limit of a class 1 material is if the flame goes up to 165 mm plus 25, which is this thing of that. If it is close to that, the material is considered to be class 1. Over and lower than 165 plus 25, anything lower than 185, it is considered to be a class O material, which is as per the part 6. So here, if you see the index of overall performance of the three specimens are taken. So the overall performance, if it is 8.9, it is lower than 10, the material is considered to be a class O material. These are few of the other tests which are done for fire and smoke. That is one of the major tests is ISO 5659. So this is majorly done for the, the cruise liners or the bulkheads or something like that. So the specimens are tested and achieve the criteria for smoke generation and toxicity for bulkhead, wall and ceiling linings, and plastic pipes and cables are specified in resolutions. So few of the products, so manufacturers, they even comply to the IMO MSC 67, which is one of the stringent norms in the fire and smoke tests. Then EN 45545 is one of the again important standards for the fire and smoke. This is considered for all the locomotives or the vehicles wherein you can see the railways, the buses, the automobiles wherein the insulation material is required. The material should actually be passing the EN45545 test for sure. This is the UL94 horizontal burning test. This is the procedure by which it is shown. This is the test report for UL94. This is again consisting to the flame and fire. This is the UV test, which is as per the ASTM G155. Specifically, I have kept this slide because a lot of applications are done outside the area. Some applications are indoor. So it is very much important to consider the lamination of the material while considering the location of the application wherein it is actually happening. So the lamination which is used in the indoor applications might not work in the outdoor. For outdoor, you'll have to go with a better or a lamination which is a more thick, which will provide more UV resistance, more mechanical strength. These are a few of the certification bodies which the normally insulation materials are complied to. You will, Underwriters Laboratory, C, then TUV, SUD, EXOA, Warrington. So this is the selection criterias by which basically any insulation material is zeroed down to. The point wise, if we go, the one is the type of insulation body and its orientation, basically wherein it is the horizontally oriented or it is vertically oriented, the location of the insulating body. Second is the element material and its dimension, what is the gauge of the ducts, probably the thickness of the chilled water or the hot water, the pipe thickness, the pipe diameter, the duct dimensions. Second is the medium type, what exactly is passing through the medium, whether it is air, whether it's fluid, what is the temperature of it. Then the environment type, because environment type matters, because the insulation thickness which is required for the congested areas might go higher considering the airflow or the static areas than compared to the areas which are outside in the open. Ambient temperature should, it is very much important. Then the wind speed, more the wind speed, I would say lesser the insulation thickness will be required. Insulating material and type of laminations. Relative humidity plays a very major role while the calculation of thickness is done for any insulation material. The thickness required in near to the coastal areas, if you say like Mumbai or any area which is closer to the water body, will need to go for a higher thickness of the insulation compared to the other locations. And considering, obviously, always it is essential to consider a safety factor while deriving a thickness for the insulation. These are few of the application precautions I have purposely kept in the presentation. As I earlier said, however expensive the insulation material is, even if it is properly designed, if the application is not done in a proper manner as per the standard operating procedures, there will always be a leakage in the system and the system will not perform at the 100% of its capacity. So the first and foremost is it's very much important to clean the surface on which the insulation material is going to be applied, to clean all the dust, dirt, oil or anything over it. Use of good quality tools, that is a sharp knife, fresh glue and a good brush, which makes it very easier for the glue to be applied evenly on the surfaces of the duct as well as the material as well. So use correctly dimensioned material. It is very much important to cut your material in a proper dimensions whenever you are applying it over duct or the pipe. Never insulate plants and systems that are already in operation. It is always recommended to start the operations after 36 hours of application of the insulation over the equipments. It is always necessary to stir the adhesive well after opening, the can or anything. It is very much important to stir the adhesive before it is applied over the duct area and even above the surface of the insulation. Use a brush with short and stiff bristles. For larger areas, a roller or spatula to be used. Ensure that the spatula is always of wood and not of metal, because many a times when the adhesive is applied over the ducts, which is of metal, with adhesive is applied, there are chances that there might be some sparks which may occur. So it is always important to use a wooden spatula or some, not a metal spatula to be used. Adhesive should be applied thinly and evenly on duct surfaces as well as the foam so that the proper adhesion is taken care of. Before applying foam on duct surface, ensure that the surface is stacked dry. Again, whenever there is an application which is happening over the job site, it is very much important that after applying the adhesive, the surfaces should be kept open to the atmosphere for a few seconds so that the surface is stacked dry and not immediately applied over the duct once the adhesive is stick to it. Joints to be fixed in compression. Additional pressure to be applied for self-adhesive foams. A lot of foams which come with the self-adhesive types. So it is always essential to apply extra pressure over it so that it is properly stick to the ducting or the pipe area. Surfaces of application areas must be protected against corrosion before installing the foam. So whenever in case of the metal pipes, it is always important to treat that pipe or duct for anti-corrosion properties before application of the foam over it. Multi-rail applications is possible only in case of bare foams. Probably if you are adding any other thickness of insulation over and above the already installed insulation, ensure that the insulation is not coated with any of the laminations. Because of the laminations, the adhesion might not happen properly in this. Sufficient spacing to be kept into insulating bodies, what we priorly saw the photograph of. These are a few of the pictorial views I have seen the insulation or the installation precautions to be taken. This slide actually shows the water vapor in the air may form condensation on a cold surface in the surface temperature is below the dew point temperature. I've shown a pipe with a 6 degrees inline temperature, which is actually not insulated. So the ambient conditions are the 32 degrees centigrade and the RH is 65. The dew point is considered to be 24.6 degrees. After the application of insulation, adding 19 mm thick insulation rises the temperature, the surface temperature, preventing surface condensation basically. So this is pictorially shown how the addition of insulation will actually avoid the condensation over the surface. These are a few of the criterias which will actually sum up the selection criterias for any insulation material. One is the temperature range at which the insulation material is applied. As we said, a lot of the normal thermal insulations, they work up to minus 75 degrees and they go up to, I would say, around 105 to 115 degrees temperature. So the thermal conductivity, as we said, the lower the thermal conductivity, the better performance of the insulation material you'll get. The ease of insulation, installation, basically the flexibility of insulation, even this is matters because depending on the applications, sometimes a stiffer insulation material might not be that convenient to be installed over small diameter of pipes. So to give an example, that is the reason always for the lower diameter of pipes, nitrile rubber, which is a very flexible material, that is considered over and above the other available foams in the market. And the fire resistance, as we have seen, the material should always comply to BS 476 part 6, to be very precise, which classifies the material to be class O. And the water vapor barrier. So the material with the highest mu value, which is the water vapor barrier factor, the more the value, mu value, the better the thermal conductivity or the better the performance of the insulation, I would say. So that is it, I would say. If you have any questions, I can take few of the questions if any of the attendees have got some questions.
Thank you so much, Mr. Amit. I think we have one question.
Yeah.
From Mr. Panchal Bhanushankar. It says, how to differentiate all insulation generics as per their temperature range of application in industry with limitations?
Okay. Actually, that chart is there. I currently don't have it, but every thermal insulation material comes with a particular limitations for the temperature. To give an example, I would say nitrile rubber insulation, if you see, it can be serviced from the temperatures which goes to minus 50 degrees and I would say plus 105 degrees. Likewise, if you take XLP, which is the closed cell cross-link polyethylene, it might go to minus 80 degrees plus 105 degrees. The same is the case with the mineral wool or the glass wools. This insulation materials work for the higher temperatures. Even in case of EPDM, the EPDM can work up to much higher temperatures than 105 to 110 degrees, more than that. So it is very much important whatever temperatures is the line temperature, because every material comes with different line temperature. It can service to the different temperature levels. Hope this clarifies, I guess.
I think it does. So I would like to hand over the mic to Ms. Swati Saraswat to give a vote of thanks. She is a professor and a mechanical engineer from ILD Engineering College.
Thank you very much, Sohini. Yes, thank you, Mr. Amit. It was indeed a pleasure listening to your talk.
Thank you so much.
And it was, as such, I'm also a mechanical engineer and working, teaching in the field of refrigeration and cryogenics. So it was very much interesting. And in a very short time, you have covered almost all aspects related to insulation. And basic what I liked very much is the standards.
Right.
Most people are not knowing, actually.
Very true. Very true.
That is, so many standards are there.
Right, exactly. Not
to select any insulation material, right?
Right.
So fire and smoke, we know. Water resistance, condensation, we know. But then there are environmental concerns, health concerns, and ease of installation.
Very much, it is very much important, because what happens is whenever, even the designers, they specify a material, even the system is properly designed. But when it comes to the application part of it, the contractors, I would say the applicators, they only compare material on the cost basis. So rather than just comparing the cost, because that is the one-time cost, the material cost is just the one-time cost. But, companies with international standards, they're spending a lot of money on this testings and the certifications. So that is the reason it is very much important to understand while evaluating any of the, I would say, the insulation materials, that it should comply to the standards, actually.
Yes. So thank you very much for sharing that information.
Thank you so much.
And the types of this insulation, NBR and XLP, which are recently used, also we might not be knowing. All might not be knowing, because you are from practical.
Yeah. Right.
So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Amit. It was a very insightful session. And now I think we can head to our session two, which is also on building insulation. We have Mr. Kushagra Jain, who is a senior manager of sales and marketing at Inner Engineering. And he's going to be talking about combination selection and application of building insulation. He has an experience of nearly a decade in the insulation industry. He has closely worked in the segments of thermal, acoustic, and fire insulation under the banner of Inner Engineering. He has had the opportunity to work closely with architects and interior designers. And now I think I can hand it over to Mr. Kushagra to start his session.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And thank you, Amitji, for such a wonderful presentation.
Thank you so much.
You have covered the basics of thermal insulation, and I look forward to take this presentation ahead with combination selection and application of the materials. So it will be more focused on the lines of acoustic and fire, because Amitji has very wonderfully covered the thermal part. So first of all, just a small concept about acoustic insulation. So what is acoustic insulation? So insulation, I won't cover this because Amitji has already covered this, but acoustic insulation. So the process of insulating a space or volume against unwanted noise transfer, whether it be from internal to external or vice versa, is known as acoustic insulation. And the materials used for acoustic insulation characterized by two major aspects. One is the NRC, that is your noise reduction coefficient. And the second is STC, that is your sound transmission class. So before we head to NRC and before we head to STC, let's just get to know what exactly noise is and what are the sounds that we usually listen to. So there are two types of sounds. One is speech, that is like the one which we are sharing right now, that is speech. The second is audio. So this audio can be in the form of either music or it can be in the form of noise. Music is something that we all would love to listen to, and noise is something that does create disturbance to us. So just a second. Some technical difficulties. I'll just reshare my screen. Yeah. Now coming to various frequencies or various hearing ranges. So usually the human hearing range is somewhere between 35 hertz to 16 kilohertz. And we can plan acoustics from 50 hertz to 12 kilohertz. So anything beyond 12 would be over-engineering. Anything under 50 would also be over-engineering. Our speech frequency is usually between 125 hertz to 4 kilohertz. And a subwoofer frequency is usually between 10 hertz to 100 hertz. Now there are again, sound can be classified into two different types of sounds. The first being your airborne sound. The airborne sound can be cancelled to a limited extent. And the second is your structural sound. So a structural sound can be minimized but not be cancelled. Because structural sound is usually in the form of vibrations through a solid surface. And airborne sound is usually sound vibrations or sound waves spread over a larger part of air or atmosphere. Other few fundamentals for acoustic insulation while designing that are taken into consideration is your RTA, real-time analysis, your reverberation time, and more RT, that is more need of acoustic insulation. Sound pressure is usually measured in dB or decibel. And the latest innovated technology that is into the market, is into the scenario of acoustic insulation, is STI, that is your speech transmission index, which again ranges from 0 to 1. So the speech clarity is decided on the STI. So if it is, the speech is very clear. So if you can hear me very clearly right now, the STI is 1. That is just a small example. So in a classroom, your STI minimum, so we have all studied from schools, we all studied from colleges, we know the ruckus that has been created there, we know how much noise is created. So in such a scenario, if the STI is from, the STI required is 0.55 to 0.65. And when we are talking about reduction in sound, when we are talking about reduction in dBs, so it is more of a logarithmic behavior rather than a mathematical or a linear behavior. So when you're talking to someone, ke, 83 dB se kam ho jayega 50%. So now mathematically half of 83 is around 41.5, but that is not possible. That is a linear behavior, which is not possible when we're talking about sound. It is basically a logarithmic behavior, which has been studied, that if there is a decrease of 1 decibel, it will hardly be noticeable. If there is a decrease of 2 decibels, yes, you will feel that there's, you know, some change in the voice, and suddenly you turn it, like, you know, decrease it by 3 decibels, the sound is half. So on various experiments, on various conditions, the decrease in decibels, the decrease in sound is observed and is taken care of. So all these designs, they are usually backed by science. So today, if you're wondering, you know, you're using some X material, you're using some Y material, but these designs, the selection process should be backed by science, right? So usually organizations dealing with insulation, they are working on two major factors for acoustics. That is basically sound absorption and sound isolation. So when we talk about sound absorption on a larger scale, the term is sound absorption. So excessive sound that has to be absorbed, giving back the desired effect. the reverberation and echo are taken care of and the reflection is cancelled out. And a major important aspect of sound absorption has to be the NRC value. So what is NRC? A small brief about NRC. NRC is basically the noise reduction coefficient. It is a single number value ranging from 0.0 to 1.0 that describes the average sound absorption performance of a material. So today, you take anything in the whole wide world, there's a particular scale on which you rate it, right? Ke, iska jo ek particular property hai, ya iska jo ek particular performance hai, how would you rate it? On a scale of 1 to 10 or on a scale of 1 to 100? So you would rate it at, let's say, it's 75% effective. It's 85% effective. So similarly, NRC is basically a term of measure on how well your material's sound absorption performance is. And it's usually between, it's measured from 0.0 to 1.0. And it is basically the average value of sound absorption coefficient at four major frequencies, which are 250 Hertz, 500 Hertz, 1000 Hertz, and 2000 Hertz. So there are a lot many labs which are determining the NRC and STC of the customized solutions, CSIR, Prasar Bharati, and other NABL accredited labs. So now we have put up a rough comparison between four products depicting the NRC of various acoustic insulation materials. So these are all in lieu with IS8225, ISO8354, and ASTM423C, which are dedicated for absorption coefficients, right? So we have taken into consideration four materials over here. On the left is their chart, and on the right is a complete Excel sheet indicating the various, NRC values that it is achieving at various frequencies. So we have showcased polyboards over here, open cell NBR, white wool, and resin bonded wool. Right. So now if you observe, if you follow my cursor, at 125 Hertz, white wool is performing at 0.83, and at 200 Hertz, it's performing at 0.69. So now in comparison to open cell NBR, right besides it, it is performing at 0.68, which is lesser than 0.83 of white wool at 125 Hertz. And it is performing at 0.71, which is better than white wool of 0.69 at 200 Hertz. So all the materials have a unique, reaction. They have a unique reaction. They have a unique way of responding to various frequencies that are hitting those materials. So, designing it for a particular frequency is a nightmare for even acoustic consultants at some point of the time. Because every person's hearing frequency or every person's hearing capability is completely different. Today, your and my hearing capabilities will be much different. You can hear something a kilometer away, and I won't be able to hear something which is 100 meters away, right? So for a person to understand what you exactly need is something very difficult. And acoustic is directly related to human hearing. So what usually happens in the case of NRC is that at four major frequencies, the four major frequencies, which are 125, 250, 500, 1000, they're taken into consideration and their average is considered as the NRC value. Sound isolation, the second important aspect of acoustic insulation. So the sound is contained in the desired atmosphere, and to block any kind of sound waves from exiting the space, or from any kind of sound waves from entering the space that you don't wish it to enter. And the material should have excellent STC value. So now again, what is STC? STC is basically sound transmission class, which is basically an integer rating of how well a building partition or a structure attenuates or cancels out airborne sound. So again, STC is a measure which will guide us how much amount of sound or how well a building partition or a structure cancels out airborne sound. So here the transmission loss is measured at 16 various frequencies ranging from 150 Hertz to 4000 Hertz. And this value is then compared to a reference value to calculate the STC value. So now This is an experiment that had been conducted for various materials, various combinations, and an STC value was deducted or deduced out of it. So in the first one, if you see, there's an STC value of like 24 dBs. The second has an STC value of 19. The third, 31 dB. So your various materials have been combined together. So when we started the presentation, the title was combination selection. So combination helps you in a way that a single material won't be able to. So let's say today your car is working because of a combination of spare parts. It is not only your steering wheel or it's not only your tires that is working. You need a combination of materials to function properly. You need a combination of materials to achieve the desired results. So hence combination, today if you go for some X material, you apply it on the wall and you're not getting that particular desired effect, you are wasting money. In that case, there's no point of using a particular X material also. Rather than wasting money and letting sound already pass through your wall, there's no point of using that particular material. So why not go for something that X plus Y is going to solve your purpose? So X plus Y together, they form a combination which is going to help you achieve the desired results. Keeping that in mind, this is a graph of various combinations in reference to the chart that we had seen earlier. Okay, so here now when we talk about NRC values, when you talk about STC values, it is also important that everyone has an idea of where to locate, what to locate, and how to locate. So just to simplify things, just to, you know, make it very crystal clear, if you see, there's a reverberation time data at the top, there's an evaluation of absorption coefficient at the bottom, and the NRC average has been mentioned out over here at 0.75. Similarly, STC, at various octave bands of frequency, which is various hertz, calculation, airborne sound insulation index, the reduction in dB is calculated using the standard reference curve, which they usually use. The sound transmission class was found to be 24. So what are the frequently asked questions when you are designing a home theater or something which is related to acoustic insulation? So, you know, architects, consultants, they all put in a lot of time and effort to design a particular structure, to design a particular building. So when the end user is not, you know, in the mind space to insulate it properly, all the efforts are going in vain. So a lot of things are being asked by the end customers nowadays, like what is the right size in height and length? What is the proper shape that is required, convex, concave, or a parallel wall? What kind of acoustic insulation works where is dependent on these things. The location, what are the external factors? Is the property or is the room located by a roadside? Is it located by a quiet colony? What are the internal factors? If it's located by a quiet colony and if you're using it as a theater, is the sound going out, disturbing the people around? So a lot many things are taken into consideration. And it is a very complex science, which takes a lot of time and patience to master. Another major aspect for any building is fire and safety insulation. So the process of protecting a building space or its component from fire and making it safe for users is known as fire and safety insulation. So it's no rocket science that why we need fire insulation or why we need safety insulation. You have been reading the papers, you have been seeing the news over the past couple of years, there have been a lot many fires throughout India. Fires in hospitals, fires in schools, fires in various aspects of industries, right? So usually the most important thing or the most important kind of insulation, which I feel personally, is fire and safety insulation, because it is in direct relation to a person's well-being. It is in direct relation to a person's life. Today, if you don't do thermal insulation, yeah, okay. It's not going to hamper you much. You don't do acoustic insulation, yeah, okay. It's not going to hamper you much. But fire and safety insulation is something which is going to cost you your life, which is going to cost you your property, right? So there are three major aspects by which fire insulation and safety insulation is characterized. That is your flame spread index, the smoke developed index, and more recently, the life safety code by NBC and NFPA. APCO Tower Sharjah 2020, 17 casualties. Greenfell Tower London 2017, 80 plus casualties. It is supposed to be the biggest fire in the history of humankind. Kamla Mills, Mumbai 2017, 20 plus casualties. Why? A fire incident took place in a market and textile market in Surat. So according to the news sources, the fire which started at 3:30 in the middle of the night took 12 hours to be extinguished. The efforts put in to extinguish this fire was in the form of 500 people, which included firemen, police people, medical personnel. There were 100 tenders and 128 water tanks to fight this fire, which had reached to a peak of 660 degrees centigrade. It was impossible for firemen to access the building also. There's something called a brigade call. So a brigade call is a cry for help throughout the state that whatever the nearest fire station is, if they can provide support. So a brigade call was issued by the fire department to all the units, which is very rare. Why? Because the proper kind of fire safety insulation wasn't provided in the building. May 2019, Takshashila Arcade. Everyone is aware of this. A fire incident that brought to light the dark underbelly of the ignorance that is rampant across the building industry. Lives matter more than any other commercial cost. And that is something that the industry, the end user, the builder needs to realize. So here the cost was paid with 22 lives of young children who were trapped atop a building. So this is where we need to draw a line. This is where we need to draw a line for negligence. The fire was allowed to fan out due to the acrylic-based roof, which could have been avoided by a simple layer of a non-combustible insulation material. Why wasn't it done? Because people are not aware. So, safety is one of the most important aspects of insulation materials, of the materials that are being used. These are characterized by flame spread index and smoke developed index as per the test parameters of ASTM 84. And the fire resistance rating of the product should be in accordance to BS 476. So nowadays, people, maybe it be the designer or the user, aim to use low fire hazardous materials after seeing so many accidents happening. So these low fire hazardous materials are the ones which do not propagate fire, they do not rip fire balls and are self-extinguishing. The NBC and NFPA have come together to form the life safety code, which states that the usage of materials like mineral wool, glass wool, ceramic wool, etc. is something which is recommended. Now, these materials are generally prepared out of base materials which are again immune to fire and comply to global fire standards and approvals like the UL 723, ASTM 84, and BS 476. We have talked about flame spread index, we have talked about smoke developed index. So, what is a flame spread index? Flame spread index is basically your surface burning characteristic. It is a rating, which is a ranking derived by laboratory standard test methodology of a material's propensity to burn rapidly and spread flames. There are several standardized methods of determining the same, and it is classified into three classes, class A, B, and C respectively, where 0 to 25, 26 to 75, and 76 to 200 has been derived or classified. Sorry. Smoke developed index, basically abbreviated as SDI, is a measure of the concentration of smoke, a material that is burning emits. So basically it is based on an arbitrary scale in which asbestos cement board has a value of zero. Like the smoke developed index over there is zero. So it is not producing any kind, it's not burning, it's not producing smoke in the first place. But if there are some, you know, if it's of some mixed material, whatever it's producing is very negligible. And a red oak wood has an SDI of 100, which is like very dense and it can asphyxiate you like right there. The SDI is measured using a horizontal test specimen according to the Steiner tunnel test protocol. So further on, the behavior of fire is also classified into the following three, whether it's a non-combustible material, it doesn't catch fire at all. Whenever it's thermally decomposing or anything, it does not catch fire. Fire retardant, which does catch fire, but it is self-extinguishing and it doesn't help in the spread of fire. So basically, it's measured in a range of 30 minutes to 180 minutes and combustible. Aag lagaya aur pura jal gaya, which should not be used. So usually there are test reports, and what do we need to see in a test report when we're talking about the flame spread index? So here the fire rating shown in the test certificate is duration 120 minutes. And if you follow my cursor, the average temperature of the exposed phase of the specimens does not increase above the initial temperature by more than 140 degrees centigrade. The max temperature at any point did not exceed above the initial temperature by more than 180 and not exceeded 220 degrees centigrade irrespective of the initial temperature. Similarly, in smoke developed index, it starts, the timer starts at 00. Furnace was started at 2.0 WG furnace pressure. At various time limits, it's been measured no smoke on unexposed space. At 120 minutes, no smoke on unexposed space. And hence, SDI is negligible at zero. Similarly, in a different this thing, there's a smoke developed index of 25. Calculated smoke developed was 27.27. And the flame spread index was zero. So for various materials, also you should always go for this particular line. Compliance, whether the specimen was tested, confirms to NFPA 90A, 90B and life safety code NFPA 101. So this is something that the National Building Code, the National Fire Protection Agency are working on day and night to bring in standardized material usage. So if we as people who are providing the service, or we as people who are using this service for end users, it is our responsibility to go for such materials to utilize what NFPA and NBC are working upon. A couple of NBC and ECBC norms, since we are on those lines. So what is the purpose of ECBC? The purpose of Energy Conservation Building Code is to provide a minimum requirement for the energy efficient design and construction of buildings. The code also provides two additional sets of incremental requirements for buildings to achieve enhanced level of energy efficiency that go beyond the minimum requirements. Scope, the code is applicable to buildings or building complexes that have a connected load of 100 kilowatts or greater, or a contract demand of 120 kVA or greater, and are intended to be used for commercial purposes. So today, if it's a residential area, they won't come poking their nose. But if it's a commercial area, yes, it is their responsibility. It is their right to, you know, set a particular standard for that. So buildings intended for private residential purposes only are the only buildings which are not covered by this code. Reference standards, National Building Code of India 2016 is the reference standard for lighting levels, heating, ventilating and air conditioning. Thermal comfort conditions, natural ventilation, and any other building materials and system design criteria addressed in this code. So what are the various types of building that fall under the NBC? Right, so hospitality. So they are again a classification under hospitality, star hotels, no star hotels, or resort. Educational buildings, college, university, institutions, schools. Healthcare buildings, hospitals, outpatient healthcare units. Shopping complexes, shopping malls, standalone retails, open gallery malls, or supermarkets. Business, a place of business or business buildings, large offices beyond 30,000 square meter, medium offices, which is 10,000 to 30,000 square meters, and small offices, which are in the range of less than 10,000 square meters. Assembly buildings, where there are multiplexes, a lot of people are gathering, that is your assembly buildings. Multiplexes, theaters, buildings used for transport services. So whether it be your train station, airport, or your bus station, those are buildings used for transport services. So what are the typical noise levels due to free-flowing road traffic? So this is clause 3.2.3 in NBC. So again, it has gone to the extent of giving various scenarios of traffic. For buildings which are less than 30 meters away from the edge of road. So 5,000 vehicles per 18 hours a day, 10% of which are heavy vehicles and are driving at 50 kilometers per hour, 65 dBs. So this is the sound that is being created, right? 10,000 vehicles per 18 hours a day, 20% of which are heavy vehicles and all are driving at an average speed of 60 kilometers per hour, 70 dBs created. Similarly, the worst case scenario, 20,000 vehicles per 18 hours a day, 40% of which are heavy vehicles and the vehicles are driving at an average of 80 kilometers per hour, the noise generated is 77 dB. And these are just values which are applicable to free-flowing traffic without honking. And in a country like India, we know that we cannot drive without honking. So it adds to this. So what are the acceptable indoor noise levels for various buildings that we see or various buildings that which we are designing? So this is clause 4.1 in your NBC, and there are various locations chalked out here with various noise levels appreciated or which are acceptable in these buildings. The first is auditoria and concert halls. The noise level expected over there, or the acceptable indoor noise level, is 20 to 25. Similarly, for radio and TV studios, cinema halls 25 to 30, music rooms 25 to 30. Hospitals, 35 to 40. Similarly, apartments, hotels, and homes, 35 to 40. Conference rooms, small offices, and libraries, 35 to 40. Courtrooms and classrooms, 40 to 45. Large public offices, banks, and stores, 45 to 50. Restaurants, 50 to 55. So these do not take into account abrupt bursts of volumes. These do not take into account abrupt inclusion of more crowd, more people. Now, there's also the NBC clause 5.2.3.1 for the reduction that we see between two rooms by sound insulation, right? So between the living room and one house or flat and the living room and bedrooms in another. So the common wall between your house and your neighbor's house. So whether you have a living room over there and the neighbor has a bedroom. So the amount of acceptable sound reduction is 50 dBs. Elsewhere between houses or flats, like different areas, 45. And between one room and another in the same house or flat, 35. So what are they noting down with this is that where communicating doors are provided. So no particular building is always an ideal situation. As consultants, as designers, we know this, that the end client requirement is always something out of the box. So when communicating doors are provided, all doors should be designed to provide recommended insulation between the rooms. So that suggests door insulation. There are cases when a set of houses or flats have to be built for the people who work at night and sleep during the day. So it is desirable to consider the design of at least one such room in each house or flat, which will provide an insulation of about 45 dB in that room. Because yes, working hours in the day do cause disturbance to the people who are sleeping in the day and working in the night. So this particular requirement is needed in terms of insulation. The insulation values referred to are applicable with doors and windows shut. So this is something that has been observed by them. For typical sound insulation specification for wall separating two cinema screens, clause 12.4. So basically, yes, at various frequencies, a particular sound reduction index has been taken into consideration. And on the basis of this, an average is calculated. Or if it's something that's, you know, like an IMAX or a PVR, they go for specific sound or acoustic insulation between two cinema screens, and they take into consideration various octave bands, which is your hertz. So there are certain compliances for fire ratings of building insulation as well. So all materials of construction and load-bearing elements, stairways, corridors, and facades shall be non-combustible. The interior finishing materials shall be of low flame spread type. Walls of the lift bank enclosure shall have a fire rating of 120 minutes. Lift landing door shall have a fire rating of 60 minutes and the entrance door shall have a fire rating of 120 minutes. So if any building today is being designed in compliance to NBC 2016, So these are the criteria for fire ratings that they have to follow. And apart from that, there are certain parts that covers the requirements of fire prevention, life safety in relation to fire and fire protection of the buildings. The code specifies occupancy-wise classification, constructional aspects, egress requirements, and protection features that are quite necessary to minimize the danger to life and property from fire. So there are again a few points which the NBC wants the building owners to follow or the building designers to follow. Every wall opening shall be protected with fire-resisting doors having fire rating of not less than 2 hours. All floors shall be compartmented with area not exceeding 750 square meters by separation wall with 2 hours fire rating. Service ducts and shafts shall be enclosed by walls of 2 hours and doors of 1 hour fire rating. The outside walls, ceiling, floor, openings, including doors and windows to the substation area, shall be provided with a fire-resisting door of 2 hours fire rating. Building envelope. So, taking into consideration what Amit sir also said, a building envelope is something that uses all kinds of insulation to protect the building from external conditions, which include thermal, that is your heat or cold, rains, wind, which is your weatherization effect, acoustic in the form of airborne noise and vibrations, dust and harmful UV radiations. These elements together, when they are put together, they create a lot of distress and discomfort for the occupants of the building and for the building life itself. So apart from this, they also help in cost saving by reducing power bills and other physical maintenance costs. And a building that is protected by a building envelope in all its true sense has a better chance of standing in functionality for a longer time rather than a building which is not covered by the building envelope elements. So there are a lot of aspects when we talk about building envelope, just a few key points that we keep in mind while designing. Attics and other crawl spaces, insulated roof and walls, insulated drainage pipes, insulated hot water pipes, insulated doors and windows, insulated electrical cable trays. So why electrical cable trays? For fire. So a building envelope is incomplete without the proper form of thermal, acoustic and fire insulation. And when these are, when the selection of these materials is right and they are applied in the proper manner, the results, they're outstanding, they help the building achieve a lot. Areas of applications with a few case studies. So keeping the concept that we've gone through, we would like to provide a few solutions, real-time solutions for the same. So a couple of them for sound isolation. So now let's consider this is an ideal scenario. You have a home theater on your right, you have a bedroom on your left. So once the person in the bedroom is going to sleep, the person in the home theater has to compromise and listen to whatever they are watching or whatever they're listening to at a very low volume. Or the person on the left has to compromise and go to sleep late because of whatever the person on the right is doing is too loud, right? So in that case, what can be done? So this is a live case scenario that I will be presenting to you. There's a wooden partition over here with a glass, and there are certain, holes or certain blocks that you can see in the partition, which were created to place awards and trophies and books. So basically, wood does not have the property of absorbing sound, especially when there's a laminate or there's a veneer or a paint on top of it, and it allows the material to pass through because there's a lot of vibration. So there's a lot of sound transference from one cabin to the other, and it also reduces privacy. So the final finish that you see over here is done with polyboards. But now we'll go a step back. We'll take a step back and see what all has been used to reduce that amount of sound. So the gaps were filled with resin bonded slabs. It was then covered with a layer of vinyl barrier, which was again covered with a layer of white wool blanket, and finally again a layer of RB slab. So there were, if we discount the first step, there were three products that were applied to gain the particular sound reduction that was required. And apart from that, there was one more aesthetic step, which also adds to the acoustic values. So where is partition and isolation required? It is required in OPDs, it is required in schools and colleges, it is required in a MD of in a personal cabin in the office, which can benefit to keep conversations confidential. It can also be used in homes near airports or traffic zones, library walls to keep calm on the inside, between two screens of multiplex, recording studio walls, and so on. Again, false ceiling, sound isolation, where we are talking about the sound reflection, the sound that is going to create a disturbance in your movie watching experience. And apart from that, if you have a neighbor who's atop of your house, they are also going to get disturbed. If it's your own private villa or a bungalow, you have it on the ground floor, there's a bedroom on the top, even they get disturbed. So here, considering the height, considering the location, considering the usage of the area and the floor above, this particular ceiling has been completely insulated with RB slabs for sound isolation. It can be used to segregate the utility room and other areas producing noises from the patient room floors. The same can be used in gaming zones, between the floors that are between the gaming zones and the movie theaters. It can be used in hotel, restaurants, or banquets to avoid the sound from traveling upstairs to the guest rooms. It can also be used in the floors below a gym, in bungalows, or you know, where there's an upper floor as either home theater or dancing room, dance classes, many theaters and flats at ground floor, etc. Floor insulation. Reversing what we saw earlier, floor insulation is something that is required. If you have a home theater on the top floor of your building or your house, and as there's a neighbor or a room underneath the same home theater or any XYZ room, that is going to create a lot of sound. So if it's your home theater, it's your duty to insulate the floor so that the neighbors below or the people right underneath do not get disturbed. So this is an example application that has been shown over here, that the cavity has been created atop the floor. The cavity is filled with NBR foam and two layers of RB slabs. And the entire cavity installation is covered with a layer of vinyl barrier. This can be used in rooftop restaurants or banquets at higher floors. In hotels, it can be used in home theaters. And nowadays, even high-end residential complexes, they are providing a lot of recreational services at the top of their terrace, which include gyms, which include several amenities like community halls and stuff. So keeping that in mind, the floor insulation is necessary. Door partition isolation is all. Door isolation, sound isolation is also important, because let's say if you've covered the entire room, if you've isolated the entire room, but you've forgotten to cover the door, the noise leaks through the door, which doesn't make sense in the first place. So this is a collapsible curtain door between two banquets where sound was transferring from one place to the other. So vinyl barrier has been applied on the entire door. Vinyl barrier has been applied on the hinge joints of the door, and then tapestry was applied on the vinyl barrier for proper finishing. So this does not allow any kind of sound to pass to the other area. Okay, so where can this be used? This can be used in conference room. This can be used in movie halls. This can be used in auditorium doors, all those places. A few reference case studies, a few live case studies that are on this, on the basis of this. There's a project near Gandhinagar called Sidraj Infra Private Limited, where the architect was Mr. Vipul Patel. So a mini theater and a gymnasium was required. So what was their problem? What was the problem that they were going to face? The problem that they were going to face was that they had a first floor residence and they had a society mini theater and a gymnasium. So now when a day, nowadays when you take a sound system, so basically they do a check whether what kind of sound is being generated, what amount of sound is needed. So it's called as an acoustic simulation. So when an acoustic simulation was done over here, there was a lot of vibration that was faced on the top floor residence, like the first floor residence, which was atop the society mini theater and gymnasium. So up, you are expecting an amenity, but you also don't want to be disturbed. So the builder has to provide you something that is going to give you an amenity and a peace of mind as well. So this was what was applied over there, where the first layer was extruded polystyrene, the second was an RB slab plane, and the third was a vinyl barrier. This was for the false ceilings. This was for the false ceilings, where RB slabs packed in plain non-woven acoustic cloths were fixed. So this is for basically for the gym. So for the mini theater, this was done. You can see the proper application is a must. So now I have insulated the entire ceiling, right? But I have not insulated the beams that are going through the ceiling. So now the beams, which are very much part of the RCC structure, are going to transfer sound upstairs. They are going to sound the vibration upstairs. So it is necessary that we take care that all aspects related to that particular environment are insulated. The gymnasium. So again, in a gymnasium, you have a lot of restrictions in terms of design. Kidhar kare, kaise kare, kya kare? Because there's a lot of mirrors, a lot of machines all around. So in all the available places, polyboards can be placed, so they can add aesthetic decor also, and they can help in reducing the noise as well. This is an application for acoustic insulation in a home theater, comma party place in a high-end residential complex called Olive. So now the top two floors belong to the same person, the builder himself, and he also had access to the penthouse, which is the terrace. So now he wanted to make a social room or a party place or a home theater on the penthouse. But his only issue was that his residence was right under, and this particular residence was occupied by his parents. So them being aged, he did not want to disturb them at odd hours. So the first thing that he went was for floor insulation, where he used a layer of NBR foam and two layers of RB slabs with FSK facing. And it was eventually finished with a layer of vinyl barrier. So this is what it looked like before applying the vinyl barrier. And on the top, because he had a metallic roof, he's gone for a roof insulation, which is of 0.75 NRC polyboards. This is the end result. So even post this, he's got a lot of insulation done because he's been constantly experimenting with a large amount of speakers and a large amount of sound systems. So there's been a lot of more development to this as well. Applications pertaining to sound absorption. So let's say you have, let's say you invested 10 lakhs, 12 lakhs for a home theater. You have used Bose system, you have used JBL systems, right? But if you have not used acoustic insulation, you're not able to enjoy the same. So hardly 20% of your entire home theater cost would be the cost of acoustic insulation. So if you spent 10 lakhs or if you spent 11 lakhs, 20% of that ranges comes to around 2 lakhs, 2.2 lakhs, which is the minimum required acoustic insulation can be applied. So wall acoustic insulation for sound absorption with 0.75 NRC polyboards. So the one on the top left that you see, the colorful one, that is an academy where they usually record YouTube videos for online coaching. The one below that is a home theater, and the one on the right is a mini theater for a society or a building gathering. So ideal places of application for that would be to get proper acoustic effect of a movie. So yes, wall insulation in schools and community halls. Coming to the next part, again, false ceiling insulation or your RCC slab insulation. So basically in false ceiling acoustic insulation for sound, so basically now what usually happens is that you lay false false ceiling. You lay a false ceiling with the hope that yes, those are basically acoustically perforated and they have some cloth on top of it. But no, they don't perform that way. Because when the sound passes through those acoustically perforated tiles or the holes and that acoustically performing cloth, it is going to hit the roof above. Whether that roof is metallic or RCC, it is going to hit. And there's going to be a lot of reverberation and reflection. So the use of acoustic material is very much necessary. Usually you find false ceilings in convention halls where there's a large gatherings to hold annual meetings or other functions, or in call centers where there's a 24/7 requirement of aircon also to be working. So in order to, you know, lessen the volume of the room, false ceiling can be used. It can also add to the decor of the entire area. And since a lot of sound is also generated in call centers from one end to the other, the sound should not carry through the false ceiling. And hence for that, you can acoustically treat the false ceiling as well. A few reference case studies for the same. YMCA, I'm sure everyone's aware of this particular place. So this was an existing banquet renovation. The problem was banquet ban chuka tha. They were performing at full capacity, but the existing acoustic insulation was not working because the selection criteria was faulty, because the material application was faulty. And hence, this is where combination of material and proper selection kicks in. So basically, this entire place was, they had put grid work all throughout, and the entire place was filled with RB slabs, plain RB slabs, to provide the right amount of acoustic reverberation. Hammers Nightclub, it's a nightclub in Baga Beach in Goa. So acoustic insulation is very much necessary because of the loud music playing over there, because of the people visiting the place, the sound generated by them. So expected problem was that it being a large nightclub and an area to accommodate dance floor and bar, it is bound to get noisy. So to keep that under check, to keep that under control, acoustic insulation was done on the ceilings with RV slabs with a black glass tissue as a layering. This is the entire solution that has been done, the final thing, that what it looks like. VIT University Auditorium, Mundwa, Pune. So the consultants over here were Epix, and the issues that they were facing was in the auditorium. The noise was carried to the classrooms, hence causing disturbance. The outside noise, mostly traffic, was also an issue affecting the event or function going on in the auditorium. So you can see where the auditorium has been clearly marked. Now, so they also had an H room connected to the auditorium, so where RV slabs were used with the final layer of 0.075 NRC poly boards, which are not in the picture right now. RB slabs packed in one woven acoustic cloth, and the final layer was again done with 0.75 NRC poly boards. Again, not in the picture over here. This is the final finish that they had achieved with two layers of RB slab plane of each 48 kg density and 50 mm thickness. And the final finishing for the aesthetics was 0.75 NRC poly boards of 9 mm thickness. Acoustics and HVAC. So Amit sir has explained about the thermal and part acoustics. We'll just quickly go upon it. So design parameters for duct acoustic insulation depends upon the FPM or the velocity that we're talking about. Size of the duct plays an important role. NRC of the product and the frequency wise absorption is also important. Tentative thickness to be known to derive size of duct to avoid higher thickness, making the duct size smaller. So even the amount of air flowing through it has to be maintained. So tentative thickness has to be known. reason of acoustic, are we doing it for sound or are we doing it for vibration? A very important factor. In general, all acoustic materials are open cell and have more density vis-a-vis high K value. This in a way gives approximately 60 to 70% of the thermal insulation criteria. So I would not recommend to use any acoustic insulation material for thermal insulation, but yes, it adds to the value. Two materials have been showcased over here. One is an open cell nitrile rubber with excellent NRC value, open cell elastomeric nitrile rubber. It has got inherent antimicrobial properties and it is easy to apply with adhesives. On the other hand, there's a resin bonded wool board with excellent fire properties that is compliant to NFPA 90A, 90B and life safety code 101. It is completely non-combustible. It has a density of 150 kg per metric cube and it can be covered with a perforated sheet of your choice. Design parameters for AHU room acoustic insulation, dB reduction frequency wise is taken into consideration. STC of the product and frequency wise reduction needs to be taken into consideration. The distance between the wall and the AHU machine, the roof and the AHU machine is taken into consideration. Size of the overall AHU room and understanding the location of AHU and its surroundings. These are all very important. Over here, on your left is a resin bonded board with black glass tissue. High STC value because of its density of 140 kg per metric cube and thickness of 50 mm. And on the right, you have an open cell nitrile rubber. Design parameters for shaft insulation. It is a complex scenario where acoustic is needed, understanding of drainage and finding out its critical areas. If thermal is needed, then other pipes, ducts to be understood as well. These areas have high humidity, hence ventilation plays an important role out here. Always have a covering layer for protection of materials to protect it from foreign particles and chances of materials getting damaged in the shaft. It's also advisable to design all MEP of shaft in coordination of other parameters. So a couple of materials work over your resin bonded wool slabs, polyisocyanate boards, extruded polystyrene boards. They all work over here because of their structural integrity, because of, they come in a slab formation and they can be vertically fixed much easily. They provide both thermal and acoustic insulation. Nobody likes ke bedroom ke piche se drainage ka pipe ja raha hai and aadhi raat ko someone on the top floor, uses the washroom and there's a lot of sound that is coming through. No one would want that. Trapdoor insulation, design parameters, distance between trapdoor and unit from all sides, mainly roof and bottom. Estimate the sound generated. NRC and STC of insulation products are both needed because we are aiming for reduction as well as isolation. Consider minimum 60 degree angle on both the sides from the sound source. Very much important. Segment is very important here, whether it is a hotel, whether it's a hospital, whether it's a private office building. Frequency of noise as per estimated noise to be matched for best material selection. Over here on the left, you have your resin bonded wool slab and on the right, you have your open cell nitrile rubber. AC plant room insulation. So now when we talk about AC plant room insulation, a lot of machineries go over there, right? So understanding the collective noise produced from all the equipments, it is important that we go for fire rated materials. Bahut sare electricity hai, bahut sare equipment hai. There might be a short circuit at any given point of the time. That might result into fire. So it is better that we go for fire rated materials in the AC plant rooms. The NRC and the STC, yes, they have to be considered. Ancillaries and surfacing materials are usually metal. Objective is to absorb the sound so that people can work and isolate the sound noise going outside. So here what we have suggested, what the picture suggests is resin bonded slabs. So there are two layers over here. The first layer is a resin bonded slab of 140 to 50 plane without any covering. And the second is of RB slab 140 into 50 mm thickness with black glass tissue. So they both have a NRC value greater than 0.9. And both the materials put together, they have a 120 minutes fire rating. Similarly with white wool, two layers of white wool, 50 mm thick, each having a density of 80 kgs per metric cube. You get a perfect NRC value of 1.0 and 120 minutes of fire rating. So yeah, white wool, this is also a plant room where it has been packed in an NRC cloth for better acoustics. Glimpses of various applications that have been implemented over the period of time. So implementation of acoustic insulation on floor at one of Inner Engineering Technical Experience Center mezzanine floor to avoid footsteps sound traveling to the area underneath. This is implementation of acoustic insulation on walls with the help of polyboards at JBS Academy, where YouTube video recording was done. This is on the walls of a home theater at a private bungalow. Commercial theater, so here, Nexus Cinema Borsod, so here, there's a range of materials used with a vinyl barrier at the back, resin bonded slabs, and polyboards. Okay, so now coming to facade insulation, something that people are aware and people are not aware. So it's like the elephant in the room, which no one wants to address. So if you follow my cursor, you can see there's a golden slab of material out here between the window panel and the RCC slab that you see out here. This golden panel is basically your RB slabs. So these RB slabs, they provide you thermal and acoustic insulation. So now a spandrel panel is used to attach a glass on a building. A glass cannot be, because nowadays, you know, we are going pretty fancy. So we want high pressure laminate facading, or we want glass facading. So these facades, they cannot be directly applied on the wall, because these materials, they have a pretty symmetrical and a very straight surface compared to the RCC slabs that we want to attach it on, right? So these are basically attached on spandrel panels. So these spandrel panels usually are attached with a gap of around 50 mm to 300 mm on the RCC deck, on the sides of the RCC deck. And then your glass or your panels, they are attached on this particular spandrel panel. So now this on selection of from 50 to 300 mm wala jo area hai, that remains empty. So now what happens is you switch on the AC on the third floor, and the guy on the second floor and the fourth floor both are enjoying your air conditioning. You switch on the music on the second floor, the guy on the third floor is getting disturbed, and the guy on the first floor is enjoying it. Right. So this is something that has to be arrested. So yes, RB slabs can be used over here to arrest thermal and acoustic leakages. But now coming to a very important factor. Everyone has witnessed fire. Fire usually rises towards the top, towards the atmosphere. Why? Because the gases on top of that particular area which has caught fire, that tends to grow hot, that tends to grow warm, and it attracts the fire upwards. So this is basically known as the chimney effect of fire. So when this fire is attracted upwards, it will keep on traveling till the time it doesn't get to an end, right? And the second is your leapfrog effect. So what usually happens is that while the smoke is drawing the fire to the top, what happens is that the fire usually finds various ways of escape. So it will break the glass. It will literally break the glass. It will jump out, and like a frog, it will jump to the next floor. And the similar thing will keep on happening till the time it doesn't get arrested in a particular place. So when you use fire retardant or fireproof materials in these spandrel panels, when you cover it completely, what usually happens is that the floor above and the floor beneath are protected from the spread of fire. So more than thermal and acoustic insulation, spandrel panel or glass facade insulation is important for fire and safety. Implementation of resin bonded slabs for sound cancellation between rooms at Taj Vivanta Bhopal. Implementation of acoustic insulation with polyboards in conference rooms at Unique Group of Companies. Then for metallic roof, thermal and acoustic insulation in Surat. Floor insulation, which we will discuss ahead. The acoustic tiles that we are talking about, yeah. So these are the acoustic tiles that have been applied. And contrary to our belief, acoustic tiles help in allowing the noise to travel upwards towards the acoustic insulation materials. Acoustic tiles are not self-performing. They are perforated. Yes, every material today has an NRC value. My body, your body, the bricks, the cement, the sun, everything has an NRC value. But its job is not to reduce sound. Its job is to give a design element and give a passage to sound so that it travels upwards towards the acoustic insulation material and let the acoustic insulation material do its job. So it can be used for a false ceiling. It looks pretty neat. So here it has been done the same. Trapdoors for AHU rooms that we've witnessed before. AHU rooms of a commercial building with RB slabs. Okay, so a lot many times what happens is that you don't have the space, you want acoustic insulation to be done, but you don't have the space to do it. Like you have some glass walls, you have some panels to be showcased, so you cannot compromise on the aesthetics, but you do want it. So certain areas of the buildings, for example, a column over here, it can be used for acoustic insulation. A skirting on the floor, that can be used for acoustic insulation. In this particular case, they had only one particular area. So that particular area, acoustic insulation has been done to absorb as much sound as it can. So not 100% results over here, but yes, it will help in reducing the echo and the reverberation. Thermal and acoustic insulation of Mirage Cinemas. Implementation of acoustic insulation to cancel out voices from the conference room come banquet hall at NABARD. This is for Taj Skyline Ahmedabad. The RCC ceiling has been completely insulated to avoid thermal loss and excessive sound. Acoustic insulation on walls in a mini theater. This is basically acoustic insulation that had been carried out in a hotel, in a banquet at a hotel in Indore called Hotel Wow. The partitions for the doors have also been insulated over there. A home theater. A town hall in Himmatnagar called Dr. Lenin Gandhi Town Hall. Again, a home theater with polyboards and resin bonded slabs at a private bungalow. So trying to conclude the session, there is an insulation technical knowledge experience center out here in Ahmedabad, which our fraternity people are aware of. And it was one of those things that we had discussed that since due to the current situation, people are not able to visit. I have tried to showcase as much as possible from there on this online platform, but in small numbers, you're all welcome to this particular experience center, which was inaugurated by presidents and chairpersons of various esteemed associations. Also, this center has got live testing for acoustic and thermal insulation, for which you can have a hands-on experience. And the center has been designed keeping in mind ISHRAE requisites to train existing and upcoming engineers through ISHRAE study material. So there's an entire floor dedicated where we can hold technical talks, which are as per ISHRAE study material or as per ISHRAE requisites. And this center is also, it's also working for the students to help them display their projects to gain funding for future projects. And it is basically to, bridge the gap between, the developing technology and the masses. It is for the technology to reach out there. So yeah, that's all from my end. And we are now open for question and answers.
Thank you so much, Kushagra. I think we have one or two questions by Mr. Bipin Chandra Patel. So the first question is, can you specify one or two materials which have good insulation properties of thermal, acoustic, and fire as well?
Okay, Bipin Chandra sir, to answer your question, there are two materials which I would like to suggest. One is your Incera blanket or Incera wool, white wool, ceramic wool or ceramic blanket, as you call it. It is made out of ceramic fibers. So that is one material which gives you excellent thermal, acoustic and fire properties. And the second material that I would suggest is resin bonded slabs or resin bonded mats, which will provide you good thermal, acoustic and fire properties as well.
That answers the question. Now we have another question from him as well. In which other different insulations, thermal, acoustics and fire should be placed across the wall or floor orientation if all three are required?
In which order different insulations, thermal, acoustics and fire should be placed across the wall or floor? So basically now it depends on the situation. Now it depends on your requirement. So let's say that, if you are working in a laboratory where there is a risk of fire, right? So your first concern over there is that your first layer facing towards the inside should be a fire retardant or a fireproof material. The second layer should be a thermal material and the last layer can be an acoustic material. Now, again, if your requirement is ki pehle humko fire safety chahiye, fir humko acoustic privacy chahiye, and my last, this thing is thermal. So then you go with a fire retardant or fireproof material, acoustic performing material, and a thermal material. If your acoustics is important, the first layer is acoustics, then thermal, then fire. So it is upon your necessity, it is upon your requirements, how the materials can be placed, sir. So the materials are pretty, flexible in placement. They are pretty flexible when it is combined. So it is entirely your prerogative to decide ke aapka priority kya hai.
Okay, thank you so much. I think that answers this question. We have another question from Mr. Panchal Bhanushankar. He's asking how aluminium foil over insulation plays a role in terms of fire safety.
Sir, now see, aluminum foil, as the name itself suggests, it's got an component of aluminum in it. So it basically helps in slowing down the fire. But now the corresponding material attached to that particular aluminum foil is also important, right? So the material attached to that particular foil should also be fire retardant. So the material and the foil, they are both dependent on each other. But most of the times what happens is that the foil plays a role in not letting the fire reach to the material itself. It will hamper the flames. It will hamper the flow of the flames towards the material itself. So let's say you have taken an XYZ material with a aluminum foil at the bottom. You have attached it to your roof. Right. And now the flame is from the bottom towards the roof. So this aluminum foil, it hampers or it slows down the flame spread towards the actual material. So that is how it plays a role over there.
Okay. Thank you so much, Shravya. I think this answers all the questions. I will hand the mic over to Swati ma'am. She'll be giving her vote of thanks.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Kushagra. Thank you very much for this very informative session on insulations, application of insulation in buildings, right?
So, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so thank you very much. This is actually, we were not knowing much about it as a mechanical engineer, that insulation also plays a major role in acoustic barrier. And it is also used for decoration purpose, and how that you can have a layers of insulation to take care of different conditions like fire, and then as you said, this acoustic and all this.
So, yes, ma'am.
Very informative session. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for being patient and giving the time.
Oh, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sandra. It was a very nice session, very informative, and we got to know a lot about acoustic insulation.
Request all panelists, please turn your video so that I can take your beautiful closing. Thank you.
Yeah, I would also like to take this opportunity to thank you, Kushagra, for this great informative session. It covered all aspects related to various insulation materials, and the case studies really helped to understand its application in particular areas and particular kinds of buildings. And of course, we would have loved to make a visit to the inner engineering setup if the situations has permitted, but we will surely keep it in our list for next society year as soon as the situations are better.
Definitely, so, we'll look forward to it.
Yes, yes.
Sure, thank you.
To add to this, Sohini, because we also have students at LDCE, so we can also take advantage of this inner engineering learning center. And as Kushagra said, that it has very many learning resources there. We would also like to take advantage if possible.
Sure, ma'am.
All right. Thank you, everyone. And thank you all the participants for attending this session. Thank you, Amit Bhai and Harshal Bhai, for being there.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rajat.
Thank you.